Cheers.
Salud.
Salud.
Yeah.
Here we go. Roast. Again, my name is Michael. First off, do we know the four main ingredients of beer? Well, that's what we're going to learn about today. We're going to learn about those beers that we make with those four main ingredients, and we're going to talk about why we like to use those four main ingredients. In this room is our brew house. We started brewing our Brooklyn Lager back in 1988. That is our flagship beer. We started in this area May 28, 1996. We actually opened the doors May 28, 1996, but we had started construction here in 1995. Okay? The four main ingredients inside of this beer, anybody know the four main ingredients of beer?
Water.
Barley.
Yeast.
Yeast. There it is. She got it. Anyway, so the four main ingredients, we got it. It's water, malt, hops, and yeast. We're going to marry those delicious flavors together into one thing. And here is going to be known as wort. Okay? That is the precursor to what the unfermented beer is. Okay?
Is it wort?
Wort. W-O-R-T.
Wort.
Okay. Wort. So essentially, we get our water from the Catskill Mountain region. Anybody know where the Catskill Mountain region is? Catskills. You got it. 87 miles north. Alright, the Catskill Mountain region is one of the country's largest aqueducts, and we use that to supply all of the water. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
To supply all of the water in New York. If we want to squeeze in, feel free to squeeze in. Make sure everybody gets a chance to see. So essentially, we're going through the four main ingredients of water. Marley, sorry, water, hops, malt, and yeast. Alright? So the water is very soft from the Catskill Mountain region. That's why we like to use it. Soft water is easily applicable, should I say, for this type of work, because we want to make sure it's not too tainted with different elements, different calciums or anything. We filter whenever it gets here. All right, we charcoal filter the water to make sure that there's no any more impurities in there. We want it as easy as possible to work with. So we get malt that comes from this mill right here. This conveyor belt, it drops the malt into this mash tun. All right, this mash tun gets mixed with the mash tun mixes the malt and the water together to create a sweet liquid. Okay, so it's going to brew in there for about 90 minutes. All right, then after that, we're going to have a nice sweet liquid that we need to now filter. So since we need to filter that and get all of the malt out of that sweet liquid, we're going to take it to the lat tun.
Lat tun over there?
What that lat tun does is it's going to be essentially, does anybody know what a French press is? Okay, so it's an upside down French press. I love my coffee too. So it's a French press that takes all of the heavy particles out of that sweet liquid. So now we're left with the raw sweet liquid. It's very good, but it's not alcoholic. So you can drink it, but I wouldn't suggest it. It's not the fun stuff yet. So we're gonna take it to the brew kettle right here. The brew kettle right here, this is where we get to add the flavors, the aromatics. This is gonna be where you get to say, hey, I taste some bitterness. Okay, this is where we add the hops. If you can see, there's three containers right here. We add hops in three separate times during the brewing process. The first is for the bitterness, the second is for the aromatics, and the third is for the flavors. Whenever you taste a beer, there's a lot of flavor profile that's backing in there, but it's not just we're going to take the sweet liquid, throw a handful of hops in there, you got your profile. No, it's a very tender, caring process whenever it comes to adding these hops in there, because if you add hops too much at one time, it can throw off the balance of the beer and can turn out to not be the beer that you're trying to get. Okay? So we have the process behind it. But this is the three bags that we use to be able to add it. Now after that, we use hop pellets. There's going to be a little bit of particles left in the beer from the hop pellets being brewed in there. Alright? So now we have to kind of filter it again. So that's where we come for the whirlpool. The whirlpool is going to spin all of this liquid around at very high velocity, okay? This is where it's going to come into play, you know? And this is how we get all of the extra particles out from the hops in here. So after this, we do have wort. That is the wort that we're using. Right now, that's what we're looking for. We need to cool it down rapidly and send it over to fermentation. That's where the magic's really going to happen. We're going to be able to ferment those types of beers, whether it be a cold fermenting ale, all right, which is the top fermenting ale, or a warm fermenting lager, which is a bottom fermenting lager that ferments a lot longer pace than ale does. So we're going to learn about that in the next room. Now, if you guys want to take a second, take some photos, I'm going to let you guys do that for one minute, and then we're going to go and follow the work into the fermentation room. Is that great? Okay. Cheers.
She sent me this here.
Right here's the Cro-Mac machine. We can take that fermented beer after it's done and fill it in these kegs at 120 an hour. So we can fill up 120 kegs an hour or one keg every 30 seconds. All right, and that's filling up, that is clean, that is also pumping in extra carbonation, okay? Because beer is not as naturally carbonated as what we're drinking today. We help that process. Now, behind me is arguably one of Brooklyn's crown jewels. All right, This is the Italian-made $1.2 million bottling line, okay? And to keep this bottling line classy, let me step down, we got a $10 chandelier. Pinkies out. Pinkies out, okay?
Woo!
Exactly. So, this is how we get the job done here, all right? This machine right here can bottle 7,000 12-ounce bottles in an hour at full capacity. Or it can bottle 3,500 750-milliliter bottles at full capacity in an hour. Those are the wine bottle size, that's correct. So this is what this machine is capable of doing. Whenever it first came here, it was one of two in the world. So it was a very special product, and we're still very proud of it. Now, the way this works, the bottles that are put on here, they're getting lifted up, they're put on the conveyor belt, they're sent through, they're cleaned, and then they're labeled, then they're filled, and then they're tested. But they're also filled with water after they're tested because they're getting ready to be bottled. Why do we add water? We add water so we can take as much oxygen out of these bottles as possible, because any oxygen left inside of this bottle will spoil the beer very quickly, okay? And we don't want that, okay? So the goal here is preservation, quality, okay? The 750, oh, and we do also, for those bottles, the 12-ounce bottles, we do also add and force feed carbonation into those beers. Again, because it's not as naturally carbonated as beers usually is. Now, the difference, we are going to take, I'm gonna get over here so I'm not sitting in front of the crown jewel. So, we're also going to take those 750 milliliter bottles that we do fill on this line, but we're going to have a little different process. That process is going to consist of not adding carbonation to it. That process is gonna say, all right, we have the raw liquid right here, we're gonna add it into the bottles, but we're not gonna cap it. We're gonna add some extra fermenting yeast and sugars so it grows and makes its own carbonated profile. It's gonna be a very unique one. So we're gonna have different beers that are the same beer, but they're gonna have different qualities to them. And the profile is gonna be different. Maybe a little bit more unfiltered, maybe a little bit more flavors, but it's going to be the same beer. That's why the two vastly different but the same beers are a unique thing to look out for if you get a chance to try it.